So we're already recording. We can just we can just start talking about whatever we want to talk about. I think for this it'll be nice. Just we've got 40 minutes to chat, not stress about anything.
Yep.
Talk about the more big picture of what we're doing. And I guess if it was like a movie, we'd talk about the. It'd be the. If it was a Marvel film, it'd be the origin story. I guess, wouldn't it?
My boys would love that.
Yeah.
I've not watched the Marvel film, so like
you've not watched the Marvel film.
No, I sat through. I think it might have been Iron Man, the first one, because they were going to watch it in order.
Okay, yeah.
The only reason they've got it is because we got a new phone, so you got 6 months of Disney for free.
Oh yeah, yeah.
And after about half an hour, I fell asleep. It's not my kind of film, to be fair. I'm more of a Godfather part
okay.
one and two.
All right,
type man.
Not part three though.
Not part three. It's just strange. It's weird, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah. Back when me and Anissa had a lot more free time, I was just taking her through loads of classic films that she hadn't watched. It was like, you know, we did like, we just went through actors. So we're like watching Edward Norton films. So she hadn't seen Fight Club, she hadn't seen American History X. And we went through like Christopher Nolan films, Quentin Tarantino films. I was like, need to give you a whole education on movies.
I got thrashed in the core in training for not watching films. And they were like, recruit base, have you seen Bridge Over the River Kwai? I was like, no, Corporal. Have you seen this? No, Corporal, right, round that tree, back to me.
To be fair, Bridge Over the River Kwai is a pretty hoofing film.
Is it? I've still not seen it.
No. Even like nowadays, because like, I think in the middle of it, back in the 50s, even now it still like holds up pretty well.
I ain't got the time. Like, you need time for movies, right? Like,
that's true.
And also, I think, like, particularly when you get to my age and you've got a couple of kids and you're starting a business and you've got a busy job anyway and you're trying to row across the Atlantic and all this other crazy stuff. Like, you've only got time for one thing in your life. And for me, it's training at the minute and then all the work stuff and then my family. I haven't got time. The only time I'll sit and watch a film is if me and Sarah have time on our own, and then invariably we'll fall asleep. So
yeah.
I can't remember the last time I got through a film that fallen asleep.
It ruins me when like I'm really excited about a film I want to watch, like whether it's like I'm watching it with like my mum and my dad or like Anissa, and they fall asleep. I'm like, hey, this is important film.
Yeah.
I guess we should get a bit more back on topic, but
sorry, mate. We're this isn't a film review.
Yeah, welcome to Marketee's Film Review Podcast. Do we have a name for this podcast?
I don't know. What should we call it?
I guess you got two options. You can go.
I've started a hashtag called North Leeds Jitz, by the way.
Okay.
You have to call it that, but that's definitely a hashtag that we're going to be using on social a little bit.
Well, that's quite nice because, like, I was thinking if just on a search basis. If you were looking for a podcast, you know, jiu-jitsu podcast, then typing in, you know, like Gracie Baja probably won't come up on like an SEO kind of thing, right?
Correct.
Whereas like North Leeds Jitz podcast, like that's quite relevant to our demographic of people who we're going to be speaking to, what they're interested in, jits, and, you know, obviously, what the content that they'll be listening to a podcast. So North Leeds Jitz podcast, I think, will work very well.
Is that it?
I think it is. What's up, everyone? Welcome to the North Leeds Jitz podcast. I'm your co-host, T, with Professor Mike.
It doesn't have to be. You don't think it needs to be anything more, just thinking out loud, like, to do more with our academy and the business that we're starting? Do you think it needs to be more generic, or what do you think? Because I definitely want it. I want us to be able to talk about whatever you want to talk about.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, we've got to keep it on brand for our customers, right? Because they're the people that I care about the most, obviously, in terms of our kind of listener base.
Yeah, I would agree. The podcast, maybe like as a whole, as a long form piece of content, I don't think that's going to be really garnering new members. When we break it up into little clips of something that's relevant to Jitz or, you know, whenever that comes about, then that, if we promote that as an ad, might bring people in. So for me, the podcast is more about giving our members a better look into just like our lives.
A bit about a value as well, right?
Yeah. And I saw it a lot when, if you look at my, you know, personal podcast, when I was doing the interviews with like Lewis, Jeff and Khalil, they're some of like my most listened to podcasts.
Right, got you.
Because like the members at GB Round A like were very interested just to learn, you know, who their instructor is just outside of the guy that's on the mat.
Get it. Totally.
Similar to like the things that we've been looking into, like the why, you know, why you care about something. Or an analogy I bring up a lot actually on my podcast is when Tom Harris was down training with us one day, and just at the end of the class, he was like, you guys don't realize how much kind of we all think about your progression outside of like the time that we're like with you on the mat.
Yeah.
You know, we'll be texting each other like, oh, you know, thingy's getting on well. Or like,
yeah.
And that really stuck with me.
Well, we care about people, right? We care about the people on the mat as students, right?
And something I also bring up a lot is, it's not a quote from him, but I heard it from him first.
Yeah, don't be quoting Tom Harris, man. You get the better people to be quoting. I love you, Tom. Yeah. I do love you, man.
It's my friend Kane Daniels, who is a really good martial artist and boss, or the head strength and conditioning coach for like the Huddersfield Giants.
Oh, wow.
He's worked at other big rugby clubs as well. And he's saying, I was talking to him about how he gets like the best out of his players. And he said to me, they won't care how much you know until they know how much you care. And it's a, you know, similar for like applies to jiu-jitsu, right? Like they probably, well, it's self-explanatory. Like once they know like how much you care about their progression and them as an individual human being, I think they'll care more about the things that we have to teach them or you have to teach them.
Yeah. I think there's lots of different levels to that kind of topic. I think like investing in people and investing deeply in someone's personal journey, particularly in jiu-jitsu, because it is so unique. And everyone comes to jiu-jitsu for a different reason. And everyone, but what's remarkable about that is, yet everyone trains together and it's the kind of brotherhood and the community that makes it work. But I think as a coach or an instructor in any kind of field, you've got to invest in your student to get the most out of them. I mean, how else do you kind of gain respect? Do you know what I mean? You gain respect because you're bothered and you care, but also because you're role modeling the kind of things that you want your student to become, right? So you've got to be all in on it. And like for the stuff we're going to do in Gracie Barra on Elite, like I am, I know you are, we're all in on everyone who walks through the door.
Yeah.
No matter what age, what background, you know, where they've come from, every member is unique to us, yet together the community is what's going to make it work. And that's what I'm so excited about, to see who comes through the door, to see the different people, you know, from, you know, the five-year-old kid who's been bullied at school to the 65-year-old woman who wants to do a bit of self-defense, and everyone in between. Like, we're all going to be part of this amazing community. And man, I can't wait to get started, man.
It is really exciting. When we were doing those video, kind of like, you know, instructor profile kind of bits the other day, and you asked me what was my favorite thing about jiu-jitsu. I did say community, but it was kind of like 50-50 with like, just also how fun it is as well. But I went with community because like one of my favorite things, or maybe the thing I'm most excited about, is kind of like meeting our future members.
Yeah, man, that's
so,
what I mean.
So for people like listening in the future, like maybe yeah, listening you, to this yeah, in 2 years time, and you know, you've been training for us for a while and you just wanted to go back and listen to the first episode of the podcast. Like, we're excited to meet, to have met you.
No, definitely. Yeah. And it's like that, it's that journey, right? I think, you know, we spoke again, maybe we recorded it, I can't remember, but maybe you asked me about what my favorite thing was. I think it was. Mm. I think when you train in jiu-jitsu, particularly when you start, it is connecting with other people. It is developing new skills. It is becoming more self-aware, more self-confident, more resilient and all that stuff. When you've been training for a long time, like I have, and you're a black belt and you're in a school or whatever it is, it's seeing the transition in others, which is the greatest reward.
Mm.
And that, and all the hardship and adversity of the years and years of training, tough training, I believe this is payback time for me now. You know what I mean? Like having, seeing people, seeing someone unconfident become confident, or seeing someone be, who's alienated, become part of a community. That is, that's the stuff money can't buy. And to be a part of that journey and to shape it and to even be the instrument by which people are able to achieve those things. It's worth, you know, anything, man. I'd give anything for that. So that's what I'm looking forward to. Looking forward to seeing the transition and seeing our team and members develop. And the growth of the school as well. Because I do, you know, the reason we're doing it on Street Lane you know, everyone who's listened to this will know by now that I live in Roundhere. This is my community. I'm passionate about that. And I want to give our community this place to come and connect and come and develop. And it's going to be awesome. It's going to be awesome, man.
Slightly changing subjects, but you know how people, whatever their hobby is, they can get very passionate about it, whether that's, you know, martial arts or sewing or whatever, your embroidery, you know, that stuff. People get really passionate about it. But do you think there is like a different level or a different thing that happens when people get passionate about jiu-jitsu?
Yeah, I do, yeah. I'll tell you why. The reason why, and this is a differentiator for me between Brazilian jiu-jitsu and most other martial arts or forms of self-defense or whatever you want to call it, or sports even. The key difference to me is the fact that it's such a tactile sport. As humans, we're kind of all, we're social beings, right? We want connection with people. And what makes us feel best, that kind of rush of kind of endorphins, is when we get hugged, right? Like when we're part of the clan and all that. Well, in jiu-jitsu, you're always holding on to someone else and you're inside someone's personal space. So Coach T and I now were sat across the table in my dining room, which is about a meter in diameter, right? This is where you'd stand talking to someone in the street. In jiu-jitsu, I'm an inch from your face. And in any other context, that would be like really weird. But in jiu-jitsu, it's kind of welcomed and it's accepted. And so I think that the fact that the martial art or the sport of jiu-jitsu is so tactile and kind of it gets under your skin almost as part of like who we are as humans and wanting to be connected to people, that's what makes it that little bit more powerful.
It does feel a lot like you've kind of found a lost part of yourself in a kind of like a community tribal pursuit of a goal type way. And it was something you said to me before, early when we first met back in 2015, and I was getting ready to join the Marines. You had said being in Gracie Baja is like this, as similar as a thing you found in civilian life as it had to be in the Marines. And it wasn't until I was actually had gone quite deep into training, and probably even more so when I had left, that I really understood kind of what you meant by that. More so when I had left, I think, because that's when I was actually training at Gracie Baja properly at Harrogate. And there is a kind of like that brotherhood, you know, similar values. And like you say, you've got the same kind of uniform. And it's that what I just said, like the pursuit of that same goal. Like in training, like everyone trying to get the green lid.
Yeah.
And then like on the mats, even though people have different goals, like you're all on the same path to end up with a black belt.
It's the shared hardship, I think. Yeah. I think that's the essence of it. When you suffer together with other people, you create this kind of, I think that's what you meant, right? Like you create this kind of mesh that kind of draws you together. You've seen it in the Marines, when we're in training, you're getting thrashed, right? Mm-hmm. That's when people come together. You know, for people who've not been in the Marines or whatever, you know, the famous saying the PTIs used to say when they used to send you crawling up a hill about a mile, it pays to be a winner. And what they meant by that is like be together and come back as one, you know, like be first back, and everyone works together to get first back. So I think jiu-jitsu, we experience on the mat at times adversity, don't we? Because training can be tough. And the beautiful thing about jiu-jitsu is that we can train really intensely and really safely at the same time. It's not like boxing where you're getting punched in the face and you can really damage yourself. In jiu-jitsu, you tap. So we can train to the highest levels of intensity. When you do that with somebody and share that moment, and you both know you've given 99.9% and you can walk away unscathed, that moment there, like some of my, all of my best roles, actually, I'll say, are with Lewis, the head professor and owner at Gracie Baja Harrogate. We started on the very first night together, and we've come up together. We got our black belts within 6 months of each other, and he's a very good friend. The reason we've got such a strong friendship, I think, one of the reasons is we've had really tough roles. We've never fallen out on the mat. We've fallen out a couple of times for other things. But that shared experience, that shared hardship, that shared adversity, and then the shared triumph is what knits people together. And like, where else do you get that in life?
Mm-hmm.
Very few places. And that's why jiu-jitsu is so kind of captivating. And like we said before, it gets a hold of you. And anyone who's trained jiu-jitsu, like if you like it, you might take a 5-year break. You're going to come back to training because you miss it. Like you say, you discover a part of yourself that you didn't really know existed.
Mm-hmm. I'd also add, I think it speeds up that relation. Like you might have a friend from, you know, high school or primary school where it took, you know, 5 years or 10 years for you guys to become, you know, the same level of friendship you've got now. I'd say jiu-jitsu kind of speeds up that process because the masks we kind of wear of whether it's just like social niceties or like trying to present ourselves in a certain way, get stripped away because of the hardship, right?
Correct.
It's like you can't bullshit someone with jiu-jitsu because it's kind of like the truth has to come out because you're in a stressful kind of environment with someone actively kind of putting pressure on you.
Yeah. And all your vulnerabilities are laid bare right there, right?
Exactly, right.
Like I'll tell you a little ditty about when I was in the Marines. So in training, we did a thing called, well, everyone probably heard of this, like milling, right? So there was a notice one night on the orders board, we were in recruit training, like week 20. It simply said, be at the gym tonight. All you require is a gum shield and 8 pints of blood. Like, we knew what was coming.
Yeah, you knew that was coming.
What was interesting reflecting on that night was all the guys in training who'd had this front of, I'm the hard guy from Sheffield, or I don't know, I remember the guy's name now, I'm not going to say it, but I know who he is. Or I'm the rock hard guy who has loads of fights from Dundee or whatever. When the milling happened, they were the very people who were turning their backs and didn't want to fight. In jiu-jitsu, you realise very quickly who those people are, probably day one, right? You have to expose yourself to and let all your vulnerabilities come out, you know what I mean, in order to kind of get on in jiu-jitsu. And that's why those friendships get expedited, because you see people for who they really are. And it doesn't matter if you've got a load of money or, you know, you think you're a rock hard dude, you come on the mat, we're all equal. And then we're going to see who's the best.
Yeah.
In jiu-jitsu, we're going to see now. You know, there's no hiding place.
It reminds me of in week 10 of training, you go on an exercise called Hunter's Moon, and it's like your first like taste of like survival type stuff. And the MLs were like, before, it was like, right, lads, like after this exercise, you'll know who's like the jack people in the troop are and the people that dig out. And then it's like, oh, okay, like what's going to happen? It's like, but then it's, you know, it's 3 a.m. There's only 20 of you in the troop, so someone's doing like some shitty sentry somewhere in a puddle somewhere. Yeah, and your fire's about to go out, and you're freezing cold, like snuggling your guy next to you and cradling him. And like one of you's got to go get some wood for this fire. And it's like, oh, fucking hell. Yeah. Like, you got to just go. Look.
I'll tell you the other thing as well, which just to finish on this topic, which I think when I said that to you about the Marines and jiu-jitsu, the feeling that I kind of used to get in the Marines was that I was part of something bigger. Like I always had like a group of mates behind me and I felt more confident like that. Jiu-jitsu gives you that as well, because you know you're part of a community who are going to back you up no matter what, because they've seen those vulnerabilities and they've got your back. And the other thing, the final thing is, if you ever meet anyone who's been in the Marines, like even now, if I bump into someone on holiday who's been in the Marines, you're instant friends. Like there's no, you just exchange names. It's like, oh, you're in the Corps, right, let's go and have a beer. Jiu-jitsu is the same.
Right.
You take a gi, no matter where you go in the world, you walk into an academy, particularly Gracie Barra Academy, you put your gi on, and it's like slapping hands, let's go. Let's go out for dinner later on.
Yeah.
You've got this like global community that understand who you are all of a sudden. And that's magical too, right? Because we're not only connecting people with, you know, 50, 100, 200, 400 people in our academy, hopefully in the future, we're connecting them with like hundreds of thousands of people all over the world.
Yeah.
It's just awesome.
I've been quite lucky enough to experience that firsthand, really, with like going traveling and being outside of Gracie Barra Academies and still getting an amazingly warm reception, and also going to Gracie Barra Academies where it's like beyond belief kind of reception, where it's like people offering me like places to stay, like, do you have work? Like, we've got jobs for you. You know, this kind of stuff.
Mate, I was in New York and it wasn't a Gracie Barra Academy, it was at Marcelo Garcia's, and Paul Schreiner there, who in my opinion, is one of the best instructors, Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu instructors I've ever had the pleasure to kind of been instructed by. And anyone should check out his instructionals because it's phenomenal. The way he describes jiu-jitsu and the way he talks about it. But listen, I literally turned up with a mate of mine in New York. I dropped into New York and the same thing. He was like, who are you with? I'm like, this dude. Okay, meet me tomorrow. I'll take you to Seoul. We're going to have some dinner. And took us out. And just like, where else is that going to happen?
Yeah.
It doesn't happen anywhere else.
Yeah, it's a very strange thing, but I'm very happy it exists in like modern day culture where it's kind of like, you know, when this might seem like a strange long story, but you know, when lockdown started and everyone was going out for walks, right? And my sister had come up from living in London for a while and we go out on walks and stuff and like, we'll be out walking in the woods and like, you just say hi to everyone you pass.
Yeah, that's
and
right.
And she'd be like, why are you saying hi to everyone? Because she's come from like big city in London and now there's like a more of a slight community kind of feel because of like this COVID stuff going on. And it took her a little while to adapt back into like just like saying hi to people and stuff like that. And that kind of becomes more rare and like, you know, those kind of things become more rare.
Yeah.
But in jiu-jitsu, it's like the other level of that where it's like, literally, like you say, not to reiterate all the things we just said, but like you meet someone and you become fast friends because you've got a shared knowledge or history or, yeah, you know.
You're going to be 1 inch from them for like the first time you've ever met. Like, where does that ever happen? You know, you're going to, at the end of a class, you know, we're in a COVID world at the minute, but hopefully by the time this airs and we're back to full training. But, you know, at the end of a class, ordinarily you will hug everyone. You know, like, tell me somewhere else where you go meet someone for the first time, like another guy, mm-hmm, and you give him a hug. Like, it doesn't happen, yeah, you know what, yeah, I mean? So there's no barriers there. That's the beautiful thing. I think that's the kind of the thing, really. When you're on the mat, all social barriers kind of evaporate, and it's just jiu-jitsu with the people you're with. Mm-hmm. And it's almost a really... And this comes on to another, we're going to go like this, mate, different, but,
okay,
but it comes on to like a really simplistic form of living for that hour. And I think it was Hoyler Gracie once said that training jiu-jitsu is like being plugged in the wall to get recharged as a human. I feel like that. I don't know about you, but when you're on the mat, you haven't got the brain space to be thinking about the bills or your relationships or even your kids for that matter. You have an hour to train jiu-jitsu and all you're worried about is the technique your instructor's showing you, your mate who's next to you, you're sparring with or you're training with, and then they're rolling at the end. And when you walk out the academy, you kind of go, wow, I've not thought about anything else for an hour. Where else do we get to do that in this day and age? You don't, man.
Mm-hmm.
So you get re-plugged, you get reprogrammed, and that's really powerful. We need that.
And the thing with that, it lasts longer than the jiu-jitsu session, right?
Absolutely.
You know, we've not been able to train for quite some time in any significant way for the last however many months. And it's such maybe a slow change that you won't realise it's happening. But a little story, and Jim's got a very similar story because I was speaking to him about it the other day. I was riding my bike back home from work up Stonegate Road, hanging out.
It's a steep hill, that man.
And I've had a bad day at work. I'm not in the best of moods. Group of like 16-year-old, maybe 17-year-old lads, like, riding past. And my bike, it's fixed now, but it's cranking really hard when I'm on my left pedal, so it's like, every time, like, I know I look like a dick, right? I'm just trying to get home, right? And this guy puts on, like, the fakest laugh and goes, your bike's effed, mate. I'm like,
thanks for that. Yeah, cheers. Thanks for the information.
Yeah. Cheers. Cheers. And so I'm like, I hit my brake hard, like, do a little skid because I'm going uphill. Get off my bike. Cars are whizzing past. I'm like, who the F said that? So, you know, and I start tearing into these guys pretty hard. Nothing really happens with it. Like, no one owns up. I'm like, you bunch of pussies. And I just go cycle off. I'm like, where did that come from? Like, that's not me. Like, I'm not someone who like loses his cool like that, you know?
I think we all have it in us, yeah, right? We all have the ability to kind of lose it. I think taking that back to jiu-jitsu, like, I think the confidence to be able to stand up for yourself is really important. I think jiu-jitsu gives you that. It gives you that little bit of self-confidence that, you know, I'm okay in situations where I'm not happy. Like, I don't have to be the victim. But we all teach, obviously we teach all our students, particularly our kids, that we walk away from fights, right?
Yeah.
We're not the aggressors, but...
And I'd suggest that to my point, when I am training, like, that's not me. I just probably, like, laugh that off. Like, you know, it's like, oh, these idiots. They don't even know.
Yeah, like I was saying before, that I've seen guys, like, the kind of archetypal mean dude that you see in this, you know, 6'3", 20 stone, covered in tattoos, show up to jiu-jitsu. And if they've got an ego, they only come once. They don't come back because they lose. They lose on day one to someone half their size, because we know that jiu-jitsu isn't all about strength and power. And actually, you know, that big guy there, after 30 seconds of specific training, is absolutely knackered. And then he gets owned by, like, some skinny blue belt, you know what I mean, from down the road. If they've got an ego, those guys don't come back. So again, it recalibrates your perception of who you are in the world,
yeah,
and where your place is and all that kind of stuff. And so, yeah, people need to have that in their life. There's too many, unfortunately, there's too many victims wandering about, you know what I mean, who aren't confident.
Yeah.
And there would be a better place if everyone just accepted everyone for who they are and everyone had a little bit of confidence, I think.
Maybe we should talk a little bit about Gracie Barra Round A as well.
Yeah, man, let's do it.
When you had the initial, you know, spark, little tinder of the idea, was there any initial philosophies or thoughts that you knew were going to be foundational to the club?
Good question. Yeah, I mean, the reason we're a Gracie Barra club is because I do believe that Gracie Barra's values, you know, the values that I share, particularly like integrity, I think that's a key one. Anyone listening from Gracie Barra, I'm sorry, I don't like the word brotherhood. I think it's too masculine. I think we should replace that with community, and then development as well. So they're the three kind of pillars of Gracie Barra. And like, I believe in those passionately. You know me, I'm the kind of guy who's very goal oriented. You know, I'm always trying to push the boundaries of what I believe is possible for me, through work or you know, rowing oceans and stuff like that, crazy stuff. And so I want those values to be fundamental in our club, but I want it to be an inspiring place. For the last 20 years, my whole career has been kind of working for our country and adding value, hopefully, to people's lives, but like from behind a curtain, like no one knowing I'm doing it. I want to add value to people's lives and look them in the eye and see that transformation I talked about earlier. So when I think about the academy and what it could be, I think about all those people in our area who can be helped by jiu-jitsu and can be better people because of jiu-jitsu. From, like I said, the kid who's been bullied at school, or the four-year-old who's a bit unsteady on his feet and don't really know his body yet and how to move, and his proprioception, to the 50-year-old guy who is a little bit unconfident and don't want to speak up at work. You know, we're going to develop all those people. And so the three kind of pillars of Gracie Barra are what I really stand by: community, integrity, development, and then it being a really kind of inspiring place for anyone who walks in. That's what I want to create, you know?
Yeah. And I definitely know what you mean by the integrity is as well. And knowing you and coming from that Royal Marine background, like, integrity is like super important to the core as well, in that 10 core ethos and stuff like that. And it's probably going to weird you out, all the things that I remember you saying, but
yeah, this is
but, yeah. But one time we were in the car and I was asking you about the core values, right? Unselfishness, determination, cheerfulness in the face of adversity, and
courage.
Yeah. And I think I also asked you about those wider 10, which I would struggle to list.
Yeah, no, I can't remember them either.
I used to be such a nerd about like every acronym, you know, but anyway, I was asking you about something about those values, like how, I think it was something about how do you like instill or use those values to become a successful Royal Marine. And you're telling me like those are the same values that you need to just become successful in anything, like even that's outside right. The Marines. It's the same values that, yes, they are foundational and fundamental to the core, but they also just make up a good person and a successful person. And that stuck with me quite well, even to now.
Yeah, man, you've got to be, right? That's weirded me out a bit.
Yeah.
But no, I mean, but listen, that's wonderful, because that in a way must have kind of meant something to you, because you still remember it, right? Mm-hmm. So totally. I mean, people see the Royal Marines as something a bit different. They're just blokes, but the blokes with really good intentions and work ethic and that integrity and stuff like that. What does integrity mean? It's obviously honesty, right? But it's about doing the right thing. It's about being accountable for your actions. You know, even to the point where I'm so passionate about this, that within the academy, the plan is to have an honesty bar. Like, we're not going to be serving people drinks. We're going to trust our members to pay for their own drinks. They might not. And if they don't, that's fine. But I'd challenge anyone to say, you can even take a free coffee or you can pay for it. The people in our academy are going to pay for it because they're good people. And that's the integrity piece, right? Straight away. You know, you can take it if you want. No, I'm going to do the right thing because it's the right thing to do. And if we all did that, again, the world would be a better place, you know.
There's a good quote on integrity that I like. I think it's by Mark Twain or some author, I believe. It's that integrity is doing the right thing even when no one is watching.
Correct. You'll see this a lot in jiu-jitsu. You've seen this, right? On the accountability piece and the honesty piece and the integrity for yourself, like when you first start training jiu-jitsu, and we're all guilty of this, you will tap in training and you will come up with an excuse why that happened. Oh, bro, man, I just was not trying, or like, oh, was that a choke or was it a crank or whatever. You've heard all the excuses. Like, if you tap, you lose. Like, that is it. And that has to be your view of it. I tapped because if I didn't, I was going to experience too much pain, or I was going to get my arm broken, or I was going to go unconscious or whatever. Accept the losses and learn from them. You know, that famous kind of quote, you know, there's no losing in jiu-jitsu, you either win or you learn. That's how you've got to be. And when you start to have a mentality like that, where you can make mistakes, and it's okay to make mistakes because you're going to own up to them and learn from them, you know, you're just going to become better in every facet of your life. I've made some big mistakes. You have, everyone has in life. Some people try and cover them up. Some people try and make excuses for them. Do you know what? I teach my kids, you put your hand up and you say, I'm sorry. I'm really sorry. I did it because of this. I got it wrong. I won't do it again. Man, that's what we should be teaching all our kids. We should be teaching all our, everyone coming into contact with in the academy. They can lose at jiu-jitsu. It's all right. And they can make mistakes in life. It's okay. It's not the end of the world. Just learn from it. Don't do it again.
Coming up to our last few minutes here. In the last few months, and we still have a few months to go before the academy actually launches properly. What have you either learned about yourself, or if you don't want to answer that, which is fine.
I'll answer anything, man. Yeah. I'm honest, yeah. No problem.
If there is something you've learned about yourself in the last few months going through this process, you can answer that. Or I was going to ask, what's kind of been the biggest surprise in this process or something that you didn't expect?
That's an easy one, because I'm leaving a 15-year career to start this academy, right? In a job that I absolutely love and have loved for the last 15 years. I'm really proud of the job that I've done for 15 years. But I'm leaving it. And I'm leaving it because I can't do the charity work, the charity row to raise money for Leeds Cares. And we can talk about that another day, right? I can't do that and work in that organisation at the same time. That's been a surprise for me. Because if you'd have asked me 2 years ago, would you believe in your job and starting up a Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu Academy on Street Lane, I said you were mental, like no chance. It's surprising that that's happened. I think the other thing I've kind of found about myself is that I think I've got what it takes to be a successful businessman and entrepreneur. Something that I've admired in other people for years. Some really good friends, you know, Matt, who runs Catalan Soccer, Steve, who runs Robertson Baxter. These are guys that I admire because they started their businesses from nothing. So Matt, I hope you don't mind me saying, but he started his business with a £100 job sent alone. He bought a bag of footballs and three cones. he now runs arguably the biggest soccer school in the north, and is, in my opinion, in everyone's opinion, arguably the best soccer coach in the north of England, right? Unbelievable story. I want to create something like that. I want to create something for other people. That's my legacy. So I feel like, you know, I was 40 this year. I've had a 20-year career in public service. I'm really, really proud of, you know, serving my country for 20 long years. Now I've got an opportunity to do 20 years helping other people, but in a different way, but building something of my own. And the shackles have kind of been taken off, because in public service, anyone who works in the public sector will know, trying to get anything changed, it's like turning the blooming ship around. It just takes so long. But man, like today, we're working on the website or the business. Just make decisions like that. Just like, oh, I'm going to make another one. How much are we going to charge? Well, I'm going to charge this. I'm going to do this. Like, that's really liberating. Mm. It's proper scary. Like, I've said to Sarah, like, I'm not sure I'm doing this right. I've said to you, I'm making the right decision here on this content, or, you know, I'm not going to get it right, but it comes back to integrity. If I get it wrong, and look, we don't mind saying on here, we've had conversations about our membership, about how we structure that and what we offer. And, you know, we differ on some of those, right? I'm having to make a call as his business owner. If it all goes wrong, man, I'll just put my hand up and say I got it wrong, and we'll reevaluate and get on. So, yeah, I didn't anticipate me changing careers. And I've been really surprised about how I've taken to this new role and how excited I am about it. And I think the opportunity is amazing.
So you'd say there's like quite a lot of personal growth that's kind of happened through...
Oh man, I'm learning stuff every day, for sure. I suppose when I look back, maybe I've been on cruise control for the last couple of years, because I can do my job with my eyes closed. It stretches me a little bit, but we cannot... I bet most people listening to this who are working say, well, the routine of work is just easy. I think we make it hard. I don't think it is hard. Mm. But when you're thrust into a completely new environment where everything matters, and building a successful business really matters because you've got a wife and kids and stuff like that. Yeah, there's a bit of pressure, but I love that stuff, man.
Right, we're going to close up. I'm going to put you on the spot, though. And
go on.
Do you want to give a message to maybe any potential future Gracie Baja Round Hay Leeds members?
Wow, what do you say? Well, I think if you don't look at us as a Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu Academy first, that's what I would say to anyone listening to this. We are a mechanism for you to develop yourself in whatever way you feel you need to develop. And that might be you want to become more confident. You might want to become a more resilient person and overcome adversity more effectively. You might want to work on your health, your fitness, your mental well-being, all the things we've spoken about on here. That's why you're going to come and train with us. Okay, the avenue for to do that is through Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. And what we can promise you is that if you come and train with us, we're 120% invested in you, in your goals, and making you a success. So see us, Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu will be amazing for you. You know, we've talked about that. But make sure you come into us for the right reasons. It's not strangers on Jiu-Jitsu. It is because you want to change something fundamental in your life. And then it'll get a hold of you, you'll love it, and you'll be a massive success. So everyone's welcome, man. Jiu-Jitsu for everyone.
I like it. Guys, if you want to check us out, we've also got a kids podcast, which we'll be recording right after this for our first kids podcast. If you've got kids, go over there, have a listen to that. If you want, you can go follow us on Instagram, Facebook, YouTube. All the links will be in the description. And we'd really appreciate if you head over to iTunes and leave us a little review. And of course, you can go to our website, again, linked in the description. And if you want to check out a class, you can just follow the Booker trial class on there. Guys, this has been the first Gracie Baja Round Hay. What was it called? What were we called in it? North Leeds.
North Leeds Jitz, right?
North Leeds Jitz okay, podcast. I liked it. Let's hear some feedback, guys.
Yeah, comment for us, man. Yeah. Let us know what you think.
Expect a lot more of these in the future. And me and Mike, I've got a lot more work to do tonight. So, Mike, any last words?
No. Look forward to seeing you on the mats, guys.
See you guys. Take care.